Today's reading is from Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. It's from the New Revised Standard Version. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet. And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people of Israel." My people of Israel. Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word, so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out. And there, ahead of them, went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped at the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another route.
Most important gifts that day weren't really the ones they tried to give him. There are a number of, let's say, interesting gift-giving practices throughout the world. For instance, in China, you should never, ever, ever give somebody a clock as a gift. And that is because apparently, the word for clock in Chinese is spelled the same way as the word death. Not exactly considered to be a blessing. What is considered to be a blessing, though, is spitting on your gift before you give it to someone, which is a tradition in Kenya, which immediately got me thinking back to make sure there was no one from Kenya I had ever gotten a gift from during my life. There is the tradition in Scotland known as first footing. And in first footing, whoever sets foot first in your home after the official start of the new year is expected to bring gifts, but a very specific set of gifts. A lump of coal, shortbread, something called a black bun, which is apparently a fruitcake encased in a pastry shell. Now, my wife is Scottish. We have been to Scotland. Only Scots can make something already inedible And then lastly in that set of gifts is whiskey, which I can only presume is for the sole purpose of choking down that black button. Then there is the gift-giving practice that our son Brian's fiancée, Danielle, who a number of you met when they were here in September, the practice that she engages in every Christmas and birthday. Her parents do not buy her Christmas or birthday gifts. They give her money with which she uses to buy her own, and then she wraps them up herself, gives them to herself, unwraps them herself, and I can only presume says, "Oh my God, it's just what I wanted." I've never seen that part of a ritual. I can only imagine that's where it comes from. And then, of course, there is the famous practice in our culture of re-gifting, where you take something that someone has given you, but you may not necessarily need or want, wrap it back up, and give it to somebody else. Well, it might surprise you to learn that God is a bit of a re-gifter. Just in a different way, a different kind of re-gifter. Three wise men travel from the east to visit Jesus, where they meet up with angels and shepherds in the manger on the night of Jesus' is born. Except the writer of Matthew's gospel doesn't tell us any of that. Well, not completely. He tells us one thing, that wise men travel from the east to visit Jesus. But the writer of Matthew's gospel does not tell us that there are three wise men. We always assume that because there are three gifts: gold, frankincense, and myrrh. The writer of Matthew's gospel also does not tell us that the wise men visit Jesus at the manger on the night he was born. You notice in the passage John has shared with us, the writer says that on entering the house, the wise men encounter the child and the mother Mary, etc. House, not manger. The implication is then that they also did not visit Jesus on the night that he was born. They come sometime later. Scholars believe when he was probably still very young, or perhaps a toddler. So all Matthew really tells us is that wise men travel from the east to visit Jesus. It is an example of what I have referred to as the Christmas pageant predicament, or the manger scene mashup. We have a habit at this time of year of taking two different stories about Jesus' birth, the one in Matthew and the one in Luke, and then just smooshing them all together into one story. But there are no shepherds or angels or manger in Matthew's story, and there are no wise men or gifts in Luke's story. They are two very different stories intended for different audiences for different reasons. Matthew's gospel is written for what scholars refer to as a group of Jewish Christians. They are the earliest followers of Jesus and the original apostles, the original disciples. They are the earliest followers who lived in and around Jerusalem. And they very much considered themselves to still be fully faithful Jews, but faithful Jews who had found in Jesus the long-awaited, long-expected Jewish Messiah. Matthew is writing to them, and he has two specific goals in mind as he begins his gospel with this rendering of Jesus' birth. The first is to fully reinforce for his audience that Jesus is indeed the long-awaited, long-expected Messiah of the Jewish people, their savior, their expected leader and king. And he does that in two ways. The first is through a rather extensive genealogy in which Matthew's gospel starts off. A genealogy that directly connects Jesus through a number of generations backward to Judaism's original patriarch, Abraham. The other way he does it is through the prominence in this scene of the star. In ancient Judaism, the appearance of a prominent star was a sign. It was a sign that something really big had happened. Usually, either the arrival or the birth of a very important person, of a VIP. Thing is, stars, the appearance of a prominent star meant something very similar, meant the same thing in a number of the pagan cultures to the east of Israel. The pagan cultures that the wise men would have traveled to, places like Persia or Babylon, which is in present-day Iraq. It meant the same thing. The arrival of something really big, usually a very important person. And that allows Matthew to accomplish his second goal in this story. And that is to say to his audience that Jesus is not just the long-awaited, long-expected Jewish Messiah, but sent by God for the sake of all of you. Of all of you. Oh, by the way, they weren't wise men either. They're technically referred to as magi, which is derived from the same word as magic. They were magicians, or more specifically, they were practitioners of the occult. And more specifically within that, astrology. But in that time, always, they were likely to be members of the royal court, of some king or queen's court. So also VIPs to a certain degree, and likely quite well off. So here they come. Here they come to see Jesus. And here they come. And here they come. And here they come some more. Because it is about 1,700 miles from Babylon to Jerusalem, or to Bethlehem, which was only about 5 miles from Jerusalem. 1,700 miles they travel by camel and foot. So really, how wise were they? Persistent, though. They were persistent. They arrive, they open up the treasure chests, and they give Jesus gifts fit for a VIP. Gold. Well, stuff. Frankincense, a resin which was used prominently in things like incense and perfumes. And myrrh, another resin, which among other things was often used as a preservative, as a form of preservation, keeping things in the state that they were. That's what they offered to Jesus, because, well, that's what you gave a VIP. That's what's expected. Those are the things that matter most in the world. So you give a VIP the stuff that's most important, except this kid's not your average VIP. And he's going to grow up to be a really, really different kind of VIP. As the embodiment of God's essence among us, Jesus ain't interested in wealth and in pleasure and in preserving things the way they are, the way they've always been. It's not that those things aren't important in their way, in the right way, but he's not interested in those things as the foundation of our lives, as the most important things in our lives. instead of the embodiment of God's essence, what he's interested in living a life, and in our living lives, in which we offer wealth. We offer a wealth of compassion and care and concern to the suffering and to the less fortunate. Offer pleasure, some measure of joy to those around us who struggle to find even an ounce of it. Offer not just preserving things the way they are for the sake of them being the way they are, but offering a new and different way, another road to travel for those who don't know where to turn in life or who are stuck. Wealth, pleasure, and preservation that this very different VIP is interested in. The wise men think they're the ones giving the most important gifts. But they're not. They're the ones receiving them. Because God, who Jesus embodies, takes their gifts, that wealth and that pleasure and that preservation, takes those things, wraps them up in a different way, and re-gifts them back to the three wise men as something better, as an opportunity to let go. To let go of those things as the center of their world, as the center of their lives. The opportunity to let those things go when they become an obstacle, not a tool, but an obstacle to becoming more of who and what God created them and us to be, believe that them and we can be. Once we do, we open ourselves up to be able to see and hear God trying to communicate with us. See and hear God attempting to lead us down new and different roads, paths. They traveled back to their country by another road, the writer of Matthew's gospel finishes this scene with. They traveled back to their country by another road, but they were not able to perceive that, to hear that, to listen, to receive that message from God in a dream, that common way of expressing God trying to communicate with us in the Bible. They were not able to receive that dream until they had laid that wealth and pleasure and power that was at the center of their lives down before Jesus and leave it behind. So, my friends, what is in your treasure chest? Hopefully, like this chest, it's empty. Empty in the sense of there not being anything in it that is in our way, that has become an obstacle to us becoming the kind of people that God calls us to be, an obstacle that is keeping us from receiving that message, keeping us from God being able to lead us down another road that we might need to travel. in there, take it out, and lay it at God's feet, Jesus. Leave it behind, and individually and together, travel that other road. And then we will truly be wise men.